Hello everyone and welcome back to Perio Hub. I'm Dr. Sneha and today's video is a clinically oriented video. So we will be talking in detail about periodontal examination and what all are the factors that we need to examine in a patient. We have done a similar video wherein we spoke about gingival examination. So do check that video out. I'll be linking that video somewhere on the screen. So with that, let's get started. So we've seen this clinical picture before in the previous broadcast. So this is a clinical case wherein the gingiva is quite healthy. There are no deposits. And if we insert a periodontal probe, obviously there will be no periodontal pocket. It will just have a gingival sulcus of about say 1 to 2 mm. So this is a healthy case. But if we compare this with a case of periodontitis, and as you can see, the patient has also lost his lower anterior teeth because of mobility. Apart from that, the laterals have also lot of attachment loss and they do have certain amount of mobility also attached to it. Even the molar is migrated buccally, and if we insert a periodontal probe in this particular case, then obviously it will have probing pocket depths 4 mm and more. So let's take this as an example and see how exactly are we supposed to examine this patient in a periodontal perspective. So this is our classical periodontal examination chart. So we have the tooth numbers from 1-8 to 2-8. So this is the maxillary arch, and then we have from 3-8 to 4-8. So this is our mandibular chart, and we are talking about the probing depth, the loss of attachment or the clinical attachment level. Then apart from that, we'll be talking about mobility, the furcation and the migration. So these are the five aspects which are very important for periodontal charting. Now, in terms of probing depth and the clinical attachment loss, we are going to examine each tooth at 6 different sites. So we are going to examine the teeth at the buccomesial aspect, the mid-buccal aspect and the distobuccal aspect. Similarly, in the palatal aspect, we are going to examine at the distopalatal aspect, the mid-palatal and the mesiopalatal aspect. So these are the 6 sites or the 6 line angles on which we are going to examine both the probing as well as the clinical attachment loss. So first let's talk about the probing depth. So here we are going to use something called as a periodontal probe. So you must have used a periodontal probe before. So this is an example of a manual periodontal probe, which is UNC15. Now this is one of my favorite probes because it has a working end of 15 mm. So you can always go and measure deep periodontal pockets as well. So here, as you can see, we have inserted the probe along the distal line angle of the first premolar. This is not a UNC15 probe. This is a Williams periodontal probe and it has marking up till 10. So this is 10, this is 9, this is 8 and this is 7. And the 6 is not visible. So we can say that this particular site has a probing depth of 6.5 mm. Okay, so what are the factors that we need to consider when you are probing any particular site? So the first of all is the factor of adaptation. So make sure you always adapt the probe along the long axis of the teeth. So it has to be always parallel to the long axis of the tooth. You don't tilt the probe in any one direction. It will only give you wrong readings. Now the next important factor that we need to take into consideration is the probing pressure. So probing pressure is the amount of pressure that we apply when we probe. So technically the probing pressure should be somewhere between 0.2 to 0.25 Newton. But how do you measure this pressure? So there are automated probes and pressure sensitive probes. Now that we are using a manual probe, let's see how do we exactly come to know. So if you observe this picture very carefully, you can see there is slight blanching in this particular region. So what is blanching? Blanching is nothing but a loss of supply of blood. So if you take your nail bed and you apply pressure to it, it will become slightly pale in color because of loss of blood supply. So that is blanching. So when you probe, you should always carefully examine the gingiva. As soon as it starts blanching, it means that you need to stop. That is your reading. So going back to our periodontal chart, so in case of health, the probing depth should be anywhere less than 3 mm. So that is the ideal gingival sulcus depth. So say in case of health, it was 2 mm. Whereas in case of the periodontitis case that we just saw, the probing depth on the distobuccal line angle for the first premolar was 6.5 mm. Now let's talk about loss of attachment. Now when we talk about attachment loss, there are many terms. First is the clinical attachment level. Second is the clinical attachment loss. Then third is the clinical attachment gain. And ultimately we have a term called as the relative attachment level. So let's talk about what exactly is clinical attachment level. So it is nothing but it is the distance between the cemento enamel junction to the base of the pocket. So if this right here is the CEJ and this here is the base of the pocket, then the distance between the CEJ to the base of the pocket is the clinical attachment level. And in case of health, the clinical attachment level is always less than 1 mm. Now what happens in the case of periodontitis? Now when there is inflammation, there is underlying destruction of the attachment apparatus. So as you can see here, the junctional epithelium has migrated apically and this leads to something called as the clinical attachment loss. So over here, as we discussed, the probing pocket depth is 6.5 mm. And let's say the distance between the gingival margin to the CEJ is 2.5 mm. Then the clinical attachment loss is 6.5 minus 2.5 mm, which is equal to 4 mm. So in case of periodontitis, then we talk about the term clinical attachment loss. Now let's see one more example. What if there is recession in a particular case like this? So here, as you can see, this right here is CEJ and the distance between the CEJ to the gingival margin, say, is 5 mm and from the gingival margin to the base of pocket is 1 mm. So what is our clinical attachment loss? It is 5 mm plus 1 mm, which is 6 mm. So remember, in case of recession, you add it, whereas in case of normal situation, you would go and subtract it. There is one more concept called as the relative attachment level. Now, in certain cases, it's very difficult to assess the CEJ and you might go wrong with it. So in those conditions, you take other stationary points such as a stent with a stopper can be used as a stationary reference point to calculate the relative attachment level. So the stopper is present at a 10 mm distance. So the relative clinical attachment level from this stopper to the base of the pocket is 10 mm. So going back to our chart, if we talk about health, then the clinical attachment level is less than 1 mm. So say it's 0.5. Whereas the clinical attachment loss in case of distal aspect of the premolar was 4 mm. Now let's talk about the concept of mobility. So always remember, be it any tooth, be it the most healthiest teeth as well, it would be associated with certain amount of physiologic mobility. Now this physiologic mobility occurs because the tooth is not directly attached to the bone. It has presence of certain periodontal ligament fibers which are interposed between the teeth and the bone. So because of that, it would have certain amount of physiologic mobility, which is somewhere between 0.25 mm. Now there are various grading of mobility that has been given by different authors. Here let's discuss the grading system which was given by Miller. And he basically graded mobility based upon the fact when the tooth is held between the handles of two instruments and pressure is applied from both the ends, then how does the tooth react? So if it is a class 0, that means it has a normal physiologic movement when the force is applied. It is class 1 when the mobility is greater than the physiologic mobility. It is class 2 when the tooth can be moved up till 1 mm or more in the lateral direction. So it can either be in the buccolingual direction or it can be in the mesiodistal direction. But in class 2, you are unable to depress the tooth in the vertical direction. So within the socket, it would not go. Whereas class 3 is tooth can be moved 1 mm or more in the lateral directions. Whereas there is ability to depress the tooth in a vertical direction as well. That is in the apico-coronal direction as well. The tooth is mobile. So obviously in case of health, it is only associated with physiologic mobility. Whereas in our diseased state, if we talk about the laterals, both of them look to have a mobility which is grade 3. So going back to our chart, mobility is present in case of lower anterior teeth, but I'm just writing it in the maxillary quadrant. So the mobility in case of the laterals is grade 3. Next, let's talk about furcation. So furcation is nothing but a place where the root would divide. So this right here is a place where the root is dividing. So it's called as the furcation area. Now, if it is a tooth like the lower molar, which has two roots, then it's called as the bifurcation. And if it has three roots like the upper molars, then it's called as a trifurcation. Now, if there is certain amount of bone loss which is seen in the furcation area, then it is termed as the furcation involvement. Let's discuss the most commonly used classification, which is the Glickman classification. So first we have the grade 1. Now in grade 1, there is just incipient amount of bone loss. That is, there is only slight bone loss which is seen in the furcation area. So if we use a neighbor's probe, which is specific probe used in case of furcation areas, it will just slightly tug into the furcation area because of the incipient bone loss. Now in case of grade 2 furcation defects, the neighbor's probe is able to partially enter into the furcation, but it is not able to pass through the furcation completely. So such defects are called as the cul-de-sac defect. So cul-de-sac means nothing but a closed road or a road which has a dead end. So you can enter the road, but you cannot exit it. Now moving on to the grade 3 furcations. Now here the neighbor's probe can pass through and through. So that means there is bone loss which is seen both in the buccal plate as well as in the lingual plate. Whereas grade 4 is again through and through bone loss, but here even the gingival recession has occurred and you can clearly see the furcation clinically. So let's see our case over here. So over here, the furcation area, we cannot still see it clinically. So definitely it is not a grade 4 furcation defect. So it can be a grade 3 furcation or it can be a grade 2. So coming back to our periodontal charting, the furcation areas are not involved in case of health, whereas in particular case it was grade 3 furcation defect. Now let's talk about the last aspect, which is migration. Now because of underlining periodontitis and loss of bone support, the tooth will migrate into a certain location where physiologically it must not be present. So over here, as you can see, the molar has completely buccally tilted or migrated. So pathologic tooth migration is a common complication of moderate to severe periodontitis, and there are various reasons why pathologic tooth migration occurs. So the most common cause of pathologic tooth migration is obviously the periodontal bone loss, but other reasons like occlusion or the soft tissue forces from the tongue, the cheek or the lips can also cause pathologic tooth migration. So we can go back to our periodontal charting and we can write 4-6 has migrated and even the laterals have migrated. So I hope the concepts regarding the periodontal examination is clear after this video. So if there are any suggestions, then please leave it in the comment section below and do like the video and subscribe to the channel and share it with your friends and colleagues. So until we meet next, take care of yourself. This is PerioHub signing off.